Morning, Saints. It's 4 a.m. Monday, January 30th, 2016, and Holy Spirit was just revealing some things to me in the bed that I had to release or I won't be able to go back to sleep. So, you know, last night I was having a conversation with Tim at a meeting, and he was sharing how he had read a book by Hank Kuhneman, and in the book, Hank was saying, in the cry of dereliction, of course, is when Christ was on the cross, and he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And what Hank in the book was saying, that, which I've heard this put forth before, this argument, that Christ in saying, my God, why hast thou forsaken me, was pointing the Jews, to Psalm 22, and that through that they would recognize the cross, because the Jews were very familiar with Psalm 22, which was a psalm of David. And in saying that, he was pointing them, the Jews, to the cross. Now, I haven't read the book, so I don't know exactly what was said, but I've heard this argument put forth before, that this is why Jesus said this. But here's the problem with that. For one, as you read in the New Testament, what actually happened when Christ said that, they didn't know what he said. They said, oh, some said he said this, some said he said that. They didn't even hear it. They didn't even perceive what he said. So if it was for that purpose, then Christ missed it. It wasn't fulfilled in what he wanted to accomplish. Because that's not what happened. That's not why he said it. That is brought forth for the revelation of us, to be brought to the depths of where Christ went and what he accomplished. See, when Christ cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He didn't cry that out because God had forsaken him. Because as you recall, when Jesus, and you might feel like, I'm already coming in agreement with Hank said, but that's not where I'm going. Christ knew, he said that all will forsake me. My disciples, you guys are going to forsake me, but my Father will be with me. But the perspective of fallen man, in our sin, we have a perspective that we're separated from the love of God. We're separated in our consciousness from the love of God. And this, of course, is a real issue even in the church, in our immaturity and not coming into full sonship. There is this spirit, this orphan spirit, because we have not come to know the fullness of the love of God. We still, in many ways, think there's a separation. If we don't feel it, we're like, oh, he's not with me. But that is only an awareness thing. The love of God has never left us. The love of God has never left anyone. It's simply an awareness thing. It's a conscious awareness. We were, Colossians 1:21, enemies in our minds. And so the Lord has never left us. He's never left anyone. But that is the perception. And this is what Jesus was bringing forth. The revelation of the cross is to bring us back into the place of knowing his love. And so when Jesus said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Jesus knew that the Father hadn't forsaken me, but he was brought when all the sin of the world was placed upon him. He was brought to that same place we were, where there was a separation in consciousness, and he no longer perceived or felt the love of God. He knew it in truth that the Father had not forsaken him. But he was brought to that same place we were, that low place where all a fallen man is, where there is a perceived separation from the love of God. And you recall, what did he say shortly after he said that? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. See, he had to be, as the high priest, he had to be brought into that low place so that he could truthfully intercede from that place and say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they knew. They know not what they do. They didn't know that they were crucified. They didn't know that they were put. No, they knew, but they didn't really know what they were doing, because they were separated in their consciousness from the love of God. And it's why all fallen man does what he does, is because there's a separation from the love of God in their minds, in our minds, not in reality. And so Jesus, in that place, was brought to that place in an awareness. Not, he knew it in truth that he was not, but he was brought to that same place as fallen man. As all that sin was placed on the world, his conscience, his consciousness came out of that awareness. And from that place, then he interceded to the Father and could say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They're in a different place, Father. An awareness. They're not in the awareness of your love. That's why they do all these things. And as high priest, he interceded for us and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Now think about this also. What else did he say on the cross before he gave up the ghost, before he gave up his spirit? He said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Now, is he saying this just to, because see, this is another quotation of David. Is he just saying it to point to David? No. Because see, this is a quotation out of Psalm chapter 40. I think it's Psalm chapter 40, I'm pretty sure. Where David says, into your hands I commit my spirit. And this is really important that we get this, because it's in the Father's hands that we come back into the revelation of this love. What are his hands? It's the secret place. This is where we come to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. This is what David says in Psalm 139, this revelation that he entered into, entering into the large place. What is this large place? To know the love, to step back into this reality in a consciousness, an awareness of this love. Such knowledge. The Father laid his hand upon me, he says in Psalm 139. What's that hand? His hand of mercy. Covenant love. First love. He laid his hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. What did Paul say in Ephesians chapter 3? To know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge. It is high. I cannot attain unto it. You cannot attain unto it through the natural mind. It's a spiritual thing of stepping into the gate of righteousness. As David said, open to me the gates of righteousness. I will go into them and praise the Lord and thank the Lord. this is the gate that Jesus is talking about in Matthew chapter 6. I'm sorry, Matthew chapter 7, verse 13, where he says, enter in through the narrow gate. This is a gate, the gate of righteousness, entering back into the revelation of that love. It's a narrow gate, but when you get through the gate, it goes boom, a consciousness of his love again. See, what happened in the garden? There became a separation, right? Not in reality, but in their minds. And when your minds believe it, it becomes a reality to you, doesn't it? Just as the Father said, who said that you're naked? So they believed the lie, that they were now separated from the love of God. And what did the Father do? He covered them with the skins, the ram skins, the blood, which pointed to the sacrifice of Christ, which would bring them back in to the revelation of that love. See, they were clothed with what? Righteousness. See, righteousness is coming back in to knowing the love of Christ, to bring us in through the gates of righteousness. We were raised together with him for our righteousness. See, righteousness is coming into the knowing of who we are, to knowing the love in Christ. We were raised together with him in for our righteousness, for our justification. Same word, dikaiosune is the Greek. But it's righteousness. We are raised together for our justification or for our righteousness, to know this love, to be brought back into our destiny. And where were we raised to? Into the Father's hands. Oh, gosh. What an amazing truth. So when Jesus said, into your hands I commit my spirit, he was quoting again out of Psalm chapter 40, David. And he was not simply pointing there so they go, oh, it's a fulfillment of David. No. Jesus was literally committing his spirit into the Father's hands, into the secret place. He was there, but there became a separation in consciousness. And what brings us back into that consciousness, the secret place. And so Jesus said, into your hands I commit my spirit. For what purpose? So that he could draw all men to that place. So that he could draw all men to that place, to come to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. To know the height, the depth, the breadth, the length. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your face? His face that is shining upon us, the good pleasure of his will. If I ascend into heaven, you are there, David says, the height of that love. If I make my bed in hell, or in Sheol is the Hebrew, in the grave, you are there, the depth. If I say, surely darkness shall cover me, even night shall be light about me. Yea, darkness hideth not from thee, for night shines as day, for darkness and light are both alike unto thee. Whoops, I forgot one there. He said, if I take up the wings of the morning. So he says the height, and then he says the depth, and then he says, if I take up the wings of the morning, and dwell in the uttermost part of the sea. What did he say? Even there your hand shall lead me, your mercy, your covenant love that covers me. Your right hand shall hold me. There's the length of his love. Abiding in the secret place of the Father's hands, where we come to know this love. Oh, to come out of our orphan spirit. It's the spirit of sonship, spirit of adoption, or the spirit of sonship that's bringing us back into this place. The work of the Spirit to bring us to know this love. This is what it means in Romans chapter 3, where it says that the love of God was poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth to bring us back into this truth of this love. What does it mean? He poured the love of God into our hearts to bring that revelation back into our hearts of the love of God, that he never left us. And he never will leave us. It's only up here that the separation is in our awareness. Doesn't matter if we feel it or not. We know by the Spirit of truth, he does not leave us. We don't live by feelings. We live by faith. This is what Isaiah chapter 26 verse 2 says. Open ye the gates. It's talking about the gates of righteousness. To step into our identity in love. Open ye the gates that the righteous nation which keepeth the faith. We know by faith. We know this love. Oh, man. Yeah, he's just been showing me so many things recently. Open ye the gates, Isaiah 26:2. Open ye the gates that the righteous nation which keepeth the faith may enter in. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace. Peace, peace is the Hebrew. And who is peace, peace? That's Jesus. My peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. But it is a reality, isn't it, in him, this peace. Well, where is that reality of peace? It's in knowing his love. Oh, think about this. When you come to know that the Father is doting upon you, that he knows the number of hairs upon your head, that you are engraven upon the palms of his hands, that his thoughts towards you are as the sand of the sea. Does that bring peace to you? Yeah. This is that peace. Perfect peace. Peace, peace. Where is that perfect peace found? In mercy and truth. And knowing his hand is upon me. His covenant hand of mercy. His covenant love. And I am upgirded by the truth of this reality. Peace, peace. Of coming into this realm of knowing the height, the depth, the breadth, the length. This large place. See, this is seated in heavenly places. The height, the depth, the breadth, the length. This expanse of this love. This is seated in heavenly places. Through the secret place. That into your hands I commit my spirit. That he may draw all men unto himself. Into that place to come to know this love. Oh, may we get it, Lord. I'm beginning to get it. So Jesus said, into your hands I commit my spirit. Now, was he once again saying that just to say it? No, it was a little reality. He was committing his spirit into the Father's hand. Where did Jesus go when he ascended? Into the Father's right hand? Not on it. It literally in the Greek is in. It's the Greek preposition en. It's in. He ascended into the right hand. He is seated in the right hand, the Greek literally says. Not at, but in his right hand. See, he's in the secret place. He's abiding in the Father. And see, he ascended to his right hand, in his right hand, which is, What is that? It's the Father's right hand of truth. His left hand is mercy, his right hand is truth. And what did Jesus then pour out from that place? The Spirit of truth. To bring us into all truth. And what is that truth? Love! 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 Jesus is truth. He is love. And that love never left us. This is the truth that we must come into. He never left us. He never will leave us. This is our identity, isn't it? What is our identity? What is God? He's love. And to bring us back into that identity, we must come into that revelation. It's all up here. By the Holy Spirit pouring that love into our hearts, the revelation of that love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Because what's the promise of the new covenant? That he would write his law upon our hearts. What is his law? Love. And when the law of love is written upon our hearts, we know it and we just walk in it. There's not, oh, I got to walk in love, right? We just become it because it's become written upon our hearts. This is what's happening in the secret place as we're coming to know that his hand is upon us, his hand of mercy is upon us, and we're upgirded by his truth. And in the fellowship of the secret place, we're communing with him and saying, Father, I thank you that you've never left me, that we set our heart upon musing upon the Lord as David did there in Psalm 129, where he says, O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know my down sitting and my uprising. He's musing upon the Father's doting upon him. The Father's love upon him. Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know my down sitting and my uprising because of your love. You understand my thought afar off. You compassest, or you winnoweth my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether, this great love. Thou besettest me behind and before, literally means to set a siege around, and have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain unto it. Only by the Spirit. Where can I go from your Spirit? Where can I flee from your face? This love. If I ascend into heaven, you are there. Your love is there. When I make my bed in the grave, you are there. If I take up the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost part of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me. Your right hand shall hold me. Abiding in this love. Abiding. Abiding, abide in me and I in you. This is abiding in this love. Coming back into the revelation of the love as we enter through these gates of righteousness. If I say, surely darkness shall cover me, even night shall be light about me. What's the light? His love. God is light. He is love. Even night shall be light about me. Darkness will not ever overtake again, because in that place you've come to know that love. You know he never forsakes you. Whether it's dark, whether it doesn't matter. Even night shall be light about you. Yea, darkness hideth not from thee, for night shines as day. For darkness and light are both alike unto thee. For you have possessed my reins. Oh, consciousness. You've possessed my reins. And this word reins, the Hebrew literally, you've possessed my kidneys. Oh, this is weird, huh? You've possessed my kidneys. Why does he say that? Because in the scriptures, the reins, the kidneys, is spoken of as the seat of the soul. Where is the rest for our souls in coming to know this love of Christ, and coming back into faith, because faith works by love. See, we're so pursuing faith sometimes when simply we come into the revelation of the love. It's there, isn't it? Faith works through love. When you know His love, faith is just there, isn't it? When you know... And so we go through these gates knowing His love. By faith, we abide there. It's not just our feelings. We know by the Spirit of Truth. The Spirit of Truth is bringing us into this truth to know He never leaves us. Doesn't matter what the circumstances say to us, what the enemy whispers in our ear. His love is everlasting. His mercy is new every day. I'm covered. So Jesus, in that cry of dereliction on the cross, Oh, if we set our heart upon that, it's to bring us into the revelation of what the separation really was. What is sin? What is sin? It's not walking in love, right? This is really pretty simple stuff. That's what sin is. It's not walking in love. And so how do we stop sinning? We come back into the revelation of love and walk in the eternal paths. What are the eternal paths? Jeremiah chapter 6:16. Stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the ancient or the old or the eternal paths. It's the Hebrew olam. The eternal paths. Wherein is the good way? Where His goodness is. And walk therein, and you shall find rest for your souls in this love. And what are the eternal paths? Psalm 25:10 tells us, all the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth. Think about this. All the paths of the Lord. What is He? He's love. Of course, all the paths of the Lord. Mercy. His first love, His covenant love. Him shedding of His blood to bring us back into that place. And what is truth? It's the word of His love. It's walking in the light. It's stepping into eternity. When you accelerate to the speed of light, the speed of love, boom, time ceases and you enter into eternity. Oh, God. Oh, when we get it, when we fully get it, we all come to the oneness of the faith and the knowledge. That word knowledge there in Ephesians chapter 4, that we all come to the oneness of the faith, and the knowledge is the Greek word epignosko. It's awareness. It's perception. It's not a head knowledge thing. It's an awareness. Till we all come to the awareness of the Son of God, the awareness of the love, unto a perfect man, when that which is perfect is come. What is that? Coming into this full knowledge of His love. Stepping into the large place. Boom! His love! Till we all come to the oneness of the faith and that of the awareness of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And there will no longer be tossed to and fro, because this love keeps us. Thank you, Father. You know, yesterday morning, as I was waking up, and this is really where I began to set my heart yesterday, and I think this revelation is flowing out of that. As I was waking up, you know, I've years I've been going, I've got to, set my heart upon the Lord continually. And as I woke up yesterday, what the Holy Spirit spoke to me is just set your heart on love. Because God is love. You know, why does God not literally show us his face? You know, why don't we just have, why didn't he allow us to have an idol, a representation of his actual face? Because that cannot fully represent who he is. Because love is not expressed in a visual, it's expressed in revelation. It's an expressed in a knowing, not by an object, not by the face of Jesus or the face of the Father. It's a power. It's a revelation, a knowing of this love. And so how do we come to know the Father? He's love. And so how do we behold his face? We behold love. And begin to say, hey, this is who I am. How am I transfigured into the very image of Christ? The face of Christ is love, beholding love. Beholding the truth. If you abide in me, see, it's in my love, my covenant love, my mercy, and my words abide in you. The truth, the commandments of what were his words? What were his commandments? Love. They all said love. You shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Because you've become love. Your motive is love. Your motive is no longer a selfish motive of self-love, self-preservation. But in that place, when you abide in me, in my mercy, in my righteousness, when you come to know the love that I have for you, see, in his mercy, that place of first love, we're coming to know his love for us. And in the truth, we're coming to know who we are and walking in it. But we can't walk in it unless we know his love for us and that he never left us. And so a lot more to be released on this, but I had to release that, and more came out than I thought was going to come out. But there's the Holy Spirit, huh? And so I think I'm just going to kind of close here and pick up there in Psalm 139. Where David says, such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It's high, I cannot attain unto it. This is the love of Christ that Paul talks about in Ephesians chapter 4. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that we might be filled with all the fullness of God, because he's love. That's so simple, isn't it? It's got to be for a simple mind. For the simplicity of children to lay hold of this. Just setting our heart upon love. And he says, David says, for you have possessed my reins, my kidneys, the seat of my soul. Where is the rest for my soul? In the eternal paths of mercy and truth. Where the Father, Jesus said, into your hands I commit my spirit, that he would draw all men to that place, to where we could come to know this love of Christ in mercy and truth. This is why he's raising up the tabernacle of David that has fallen, to bring us into the revelation of the love of Christ, that we would come to maturity in love. That's what 1 Corinthians 13 says, right? When that which is perfect is come, then that which is part shall be done away. See, what's the in part? The Holy Spirit. Because see, what's the purpose of the Holy Spirit? To bring us into the fullness of love. And when he's done that, then those giftings of the Holy Spirit, they performed what they were to do. It was to bring us into that. The perfect is coming into the fullness of the love of Christ, of knowing this love. That's the perfection. You have possessed my reins. You have covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. How marvelous are your works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My soul has found its rest in knowing this love. No longer striving, but it's found its rest in knowing this love. As David said, return unto thy rest, O my soul. And he was talking about the secret place. Brought back into the land of the living. Brought back into the goodness of God. In this place of knowing his love is where all the goodness of God is released. All of his good pleasure towards us, his face shining upon us, the good pleasure of his will towards us, it's received in this love. And as long as we're separated from that, separated from the knowledge of that, we cannot receive the fullness, all of this goodness of who he is. By faith, we must know this love and receive of it. How marvelous are your works, and that my soul knoweth right well. My substance was not hid from you when I was made in secret. Made in secret. See, he made us there. That's where he made us, in the secret place. We were made there. We were made for love. My substance was not hid from you when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Thine eyes did behold my substance, being yet unperfect. And in your book all my members were written, while in continuance they were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them. How precious are your thoughts towards me, O God! How great is the sum of them. If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with you. See, there is coming into that. There is no separation. I am always with you in this love. And so, Father, I thank you by your Holy Spirit that you poured your love of God into our hearts to bring us into the revelation of that love through the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Sonship, to bring us out of that orphan spirit. We're no longer orphans, but by your love, by the Holy Spirit bringing us into the revelation of that, we become your sons. To know your love, where we abide in the secret place. And Father, we may become a hiding place to draw other people into that reality, where we come into our destiny in you, love. Father, I thank you for connecting the dots. Connecting the dots in our hearts and our minds, and for the law being written upon our hearts by the Holy Spirit, the law of love, that we become that as we come back into a consciousness, a Christ consciousness, a love consciousness, a love awareness. Jesus Christ. Oh, I got a whole nother message I want to release on this, but that'll have to come another day. Shalom, shalom, perfect peace, and knowing his love. Amen.